Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God.
John chapter number 8 tonight. John chapter number 8. Jesus made this statement in verse 30 to 32. Call your attention there as our text. It says, as he spake these words, many believed on him. Proof positive, what the word says is what's going to cause people ultimately to believe. You need the word of God. You need the Spirit of God. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Now clearly, he doesn't say, if ye continue in my word, then you'll be saved and won't lose your salvation. All it says is, if ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. You can be saved and not be a disciple. As a matter of fact, most of Christianity is probably not his disciples. A disciple is a follower in learning. Some people only disciple for so long and then they've learned it all and so they don't need it any longer. But the secret to success in the Christian life, notice, is right in the context there. We ought to be disciples throughout our entire life. We will always be students of the Word of God, but the key to it is if ye continue. You know, the success factor is that of faithfulness. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 2, moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. Not necessarily talented, good looking, or any of the sort, rich and famous, faithful. And that is a gift, that is a talent per se that any one of us can exhibit. Anybody can be faithful. We may not all be cute, and we may not all have a pocket full of money, and we may not all have the highest IQs, but faithfulness doesn't require any of those things. Amen. Just be faithful. And since that's the requirement, you know, people go for job interviews. And when you go to that, what you want to know is, what's the requirement? What do you require of me? And God says, well, moreover. So whatever other requirements come up, the most important one is that of faithfulness. I've had many younger preachers ask me, I used to be one, but now that I'm at the other end, I have a lot of younger preachers ask me, what's the secret to longevity in the ministry? So I give him my years of wisdom. No, just be faithful. I don't know. You get up every day, no matter what happens, just keep going. That's it. Galatians 6:9 says, and let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. Acts 17 and verse 21, all the Athenians and strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else, but either to tell or hear some new thing. God help us to continue in the things which we've learned and been assured of. That's really what's going to matter when it's all said and done. The book of Acts shows us the stick-to-itiveness of the early church. Thank God they did. There was only a... You know, we would call it, and this is not to be disparaging towards them, but just a ragtag bunch of believers that just stuck in there. They just stayed at it, and they continued to do what they knew was right to do, and left the rest up to God. 1 Corinthians 3 and verse 6 and 7, as it applies to salvation, but it applies to most things in the Christian life. Paul said, I have planted, Apollos watered, But God gave the increase. And because of that, 1, 2, 3, ABC, he said in verse 7, so then, neither is he that planteth anything, who was that? That was him. Neither he that watereth, that was Apollos, but God that giveth the increase. God's the one that gives the increase. What's our job? Just to continue. I want to give you several things that we need to continue in our Christian lives, if one day we want to hear him say, well done, good and faithful servant. The first thing is to continue, and I know this is going to sound so redundant, but continue in prayer. Prayer is so vital to the Christian life. It is our connection. It's our hotline to God. In Acts 1:14, it says, these all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren. You know, this was a time afterwards where they were a hunted bunch. And what did they do? Just like Daniel back in the Old Testament. Once the decree had gone out, there's going to be nobody that's going to ask anything of anyone, any God, except the king. He went home, and just as he had always done, some theorized that maybe he was being showy, but I just believe that where he prayed, which was visible to anyone, was where he always prayed. It wasn't he was like saying, in your face, buddy. But he prayed just like he always did. Prayer is that important. Luke 18:1, Jesus taught a parable, which is taking something physical in order and utilizing that in order to present a spiritual truth. So he felt as though it was important enough, not just a little sidebar, but rather it's in Luke 18 verse 1. So this is like, I want this to be right up front. He taught a parable on this wise, that men ought always to pray and not to faint. Couple of things with that, we're supposed to always do it and don't ever stop. Don't ever stop. Paul said to the Colossians in Colossians 4:2, continue in prayer and watch in the same with thanksgiving. Watch what? Watch for the answers. Till the answer comes, you got to keep praying. Continue in prayer and watch in the same with thanksgiving. Clearly believing that you'll receive. Why else would you thank him? And then he said to the Thessalonians in 1 Thessalonians 5:17, pray without ceasing. People that don't want to pray or don't find the benefit of it, they'll say strange things like, well, do you mean to tell me that we're supposed to just kneel down and just pray all the time? No, doesn't say that. Stop being a wise guy. It says, pray without ceasing. Simply undertake the practice of prayer and don't ever give it up. Realize that it does the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. So don't ever stop doing that. But some people just pray for show at a meal. Tell you something else that we need to continue to do. Not just continue to pray, but continue to practice. Did you ever hear someone say, practice what you preach? Well, we need to practice. It says again in Acts chapter 2, isn't it strange how so many of these things that we look at today, we're being encouraged to do today, began back there in the early church 2,000 years ago. I guess that tells me they must have continued for us to be doing it today. Acts 2:42, and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in breaking of bread and in prayers. They practiced. what they, Acts 2:46, and they continuing daily with one accord in the temple, breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart. Paul, no doubt, had plenty of thoughts for all that he endured in his life. I'm sure there were plenty of times where he thought, I can't stand no more. Yet he told Timothy in 2 Timothy 3, in verse 10 and 11, but thou hast fully known my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience, persecutions, afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra. What persecutions, he said, I endured. But out of them all, the Lord delivered me. I wonder, I guess you never know what would happen if things were different. But in this particular case, it seems as though the end result of his deliverance had to do with the fact that he continued. Had he not continued, who knows? He again said in 2 Timothy 3:14, he said, but continue thou in the things that thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. So you find a good, faithful teacher and you follow him. As Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. They continued praying. They continued practicing. Number three, they continued knocking. This could be used in a number of things. It could be used for prayer. It could be used for leading someone to Christ. It doesn't necessarily have to be going door to door. I mean, that would fit. But in the context of what Jesus said in Revelation 3:20, it doesn't have anything to do with knocking on somebody's door, but rather knocking on somebody's heart. He said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and he with me. Jesus was pretty plain when he said in Matthew 7 and verse 7 and 8, ask and it shall be given you. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. You know, we're not as persistent sometimes as we ought to be. We fail to keep knocking. I think of over there in Acts chapter 12 and verse 16. Remember when Peter finally got out? No, he got out. When he got out, he goes to where his friends were, and it says Peter continued knocking. They weren't answering the door at first. He didn't say, oh, I guess they're busy. I guess they've given up on me. No, he continued knocking, and when they had opened the door, they saw him and they were astonished. Keep knocking. Be persistent. The Bible talks about the importunate woman. Remember, she had been slighted in, no doubt, some form of judicial system, and yet she kept going. And he said, lest she weary me by her continual coming, I'm just going to have to go ahead and grant her request. If you want something badly enough, you'll pursue it. And if you don't, If it's not worth continuing, then probably it's not worth having. Some people can take or leave just about anything. There's some things that we ought to continue to knock about. I'll tell you something else too. We ought to continue in whatever ministry God has given you. No matter what it is, if you clean a toilet, then bless God, clean the toilet to the best of your ability. Whether you eat or you drink or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. Not everyone is going to be a teacher or a preacher or an evangelist or a missionary of sorts. But whatever it is that we do, and we all do something, just be faithful to do it. It says in Acts 18:11, and he continued there a year and 6 months teaching the word of God among them. I wonder how many said, get out of town. 1 Peter 4 and verse 10, as every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Whatever it is that you have, whatever talent or ability you have, use it for the glory of God. Say, well, I don't have anything. You know, then go back to number one. Continue to pray. Amen. Anybody can pray. I guarantee you that when we get to heaven, we'll see prayer warriors being rewarded over and over and over again because they just, hey, who knows where we are today or where we might not be today if it wasn't for the prayers of someone else. We don't know. All we do know is this, that the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Well, I believe God. It says in Acts 6 and verse number 1, in those days when the number of the disciples was multiplied, there arose a murmuring amongst the Grecians against the Hebrews because their widows were neglected in the daily ministration. You know, when someone is not faithful to what they're called to do, it doesn't matter. A menial task like serving some tables can set some people off. I saw it yesterday. Brother Louis had made sure that there was some pizza there. And what Allison was just beside herself out there. She said, is pizza out here? She took the box home, is right. She wasn't going to let that go to waste. Was that him on the corner? Going on in that, in Acts 6:4, he said, but we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. This idea that, you know, many people do certain things that they do for a little teeny tiny bit of time. And say, well, I did this, I did that. You know, most people are living Christian-wise in the realm of used to. I used to do this. I used to do that. I once was this. I once was that. Well, what caused you to stop? Let's face it, there's only so many things really, you know, in a general sense that we can do for the cause of Christ. So whatever it is that you do, do it faithfully. 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 17 to 20 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Behold, old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. All things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, hath given us the ministry of reconciliation. Not necessarily the ministry of going and knocking on every door in creation, but we have a responsibility to those that we come in contact with, no matter where they are, to care enough about their souls to see them reconciled to God. No matter what it is, to utilize everything at our disposal to hopefully make an influence. Do something. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works. Glorify your Father which is in heaven. To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. You know, if we were an ambassador for the United States or any other country, wouldn't we think that that was a pretty important job to have? a high calling, a great responsibility, that people would be depending on us? Yeah, well, we're ambassadors for Christ. And he says, as though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. Another thing we ought to be consistent in is our speech. Our speech. In Acts 20, in verse 7, it says, upon the first day of the week, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul preached unto them, ready to depart on the morrow, and continued his speech until midnight. Now, I'm going to kind of twist that a little bit. Obviously, he was a long-winded preacher. Be thankful for me. I have no intention to preach until midnight. Howbeit, let's look at it this way. He continued his speech until midnight. They have that, whatever they call that, clock that's winding down. It's winding down to midnight. And they keep telling us, oh, we're at 5 minutes or 12. Doomsday clock. There you go. That's what it's called. Well, look at it that way. He continued his speech until midnight. All that we have to say, putting forth the word of God, as I just mentioned back in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, trying to see people reconciled to Christ, we ought to keep on doing it. Keep that speech going. Luke 6 and verse 45 said, a good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is good. And an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is evil. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. It's only a matter of time. If you let somebody speak, matter of fact, I'm pretty sure that Brother George back there probably knows a thing or two about that. If you just let somebody speak long enough, they'll either justify themselves or they'll condemn themselves. And we ought not to condemn ourselves by speaking and eventually allowing the contents of our heart, if it's not right, to spill out. You ever hear someone say something like, oop, it slipped. No, it didn't slip. It oozed out because that's what your heart is full of. There's no slipping. Let your speech, Paul said to the Colossians, Colossians 4:6, let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how to answer every man. We have control over what we say. But as Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, whatever is jam-packed into that vessel, that deceitful vessel called the heart, eventually is going to come out. But we ought to be consistent in the things that we say. James talked about that, about bitter and sweet coming out of the same. This ought not to be, he said. Titus 2 in verse 7 and 8 said, in all things showing thyself a pattern of good works, in doctrine showing uncorruptness, gravity, sincerity, sound speech that cannot be condemned. Sadly, some people have drifted away, apostatized, because, I don't know, they didn't find the word of God sufficient, as they did over there in the book of Acts. Some of them wanted nothing more to do than to find some new thing. And they're blown about with every wind of doctrine. So something new comes along and it's like, well, that sounds good. Our speech ought to be consistent. Our speech ought to be seasoned with salt. It ought to be good. It ought to be sound. I'll tell you something else that we ought to continue in. We ought to continue in, which is not often practiced these days, sadly, and I'll be the first one to own up to it as well, is that of fasting. Fasting is one of those things. Again, in the book of Acts, Acts 27:33, and while the day was coming on, Paul besought them all to take some meat. saying, "This day is the 14th day that ye have tarried and continued fasting, having taken nothing." When was the last time you fasted for 14 days? I mean, we read about fasting that took place for 40 days. You know, can't even imagine that. You say, "Preacher, you're telling me you never fasted for 40 days? I'm telling you, watch this, I've never fasted for 40 days.
Not alone.
Did I look like Joe? I'm really going to show my carnality now. I've never fasted for 14 days. This is some serious business here. Some people do this. Some people are that serious about the answers to prayer. By the way, fasting is not designed for health benefit. I mean, people talk about, well, you purge your system and all. If I want to purge my, I know a way to purge my system. You eat a lot. You know, what goes in comes out. So if you want to purge your system, keep the thing going, right? That's my idea about purging. Fasting is denying the flesh. But denying the flesh, and it can be done for water or food or sexual activity. Those are the types of fast. But if you're not going to pray, then you might as well eat and drink and be merry. Jesus said this, and his disciples were shocked that they didn't have the ability, and God had given them the powers. They had the powers to raise the dead and cast out devils and all of these things. But every now and then they would encounter something that was beyond their abilities, or so they thought. And it says in Matthew 17, in verse 18 to 21, Jesus rebuked the devil, and he departed out of him, and the child was cured from that very hour. Jesus never misfired. Then came the disciples to Jesus apart and said, "Why could not we cast him out?" And Jesus said unto them, "Because of your unbelief. For verily I say unto you, if ye have faith as a grain of mustard seed, ye shall say unto this mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. Howbeit," and this is the key, this is what I want you to see, "howbeit," he said, "this kind goeth not out but by prayer and fasting." There are certain things, and I don't have a list, and Jesus didn't give a list here, except for this particular incident. He said, there's some things that are not going to be accomplished but by fasting and prayer. What does fasting do? Fasting is the next level of prayer. It shows you mean business. It shows that you're willing to deny your flesh in order to communicate with God. We don't do all that often, but we should continue, because they did, and we see the successes of the early church. Maybe some of our successes would be greatly enhanced if we availed ourselves to more fasting. So let me ask for some volunteers right now. I'll give you one last one quickly. Another thing that they continued was their testimony. Their testimony. How many people do you know that once upon a time in their Christian lives, they were something sterling? They were good. They were spiritual. They were really the poster child for Christianity. If you looked up their name in the dictionary or looked up the term Christian, there they were. But something happened. You know, it takes quite a while to develop a testimony, a character, if you will. But it can be destroyed. It can be wiped out with, well, I've told you many times, you will more often than not be known for the last worst deed you ever did. Ask Rahab the harlot. Acts 26 and verse 22, having therefore obtained help of God, he said, I continue unto this day, witnessing both to small and great, having none other things than those which the prophets and Moses did say should come. Just continued doing the right thing. Bob Jones Sr. said this, do right, though the stars of heaven fall, do right. In Luke 21, this is a tribulation text, but I think the same principle applies here. In verse 10 to 13, then said he unto them, nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and great earthquakes shall be in divers places, and famines and pestilences and fearful sights and great signs shall there be from heaven. But before all these, they shall lay their hands on you and persecute you, delivering you up to the synagogues and into prisons, being brought before kings and rulers for my name's sake. And he said, and it shall turn to you for a testimony. You want a testimony? He said, these are the things that are going to come your way that you need to endure, that you need to just stick with it. And when you do those things, people will look at you and they'll say, whoa, that guy, that gal's got a testimony there. This isn't anything new. People have maintained testimonies going all the way back to the book of Genesis, like a guy like Enoch. We read about him in Hebrews chapter 11. It says in verse 5 and 6, by faith Enoch was translated that he should not see death. And it was not found because God translated him. And before his translation, he had this testimony. Oh, I bet it was tough. No, he had this testimony that he pleased God. Oh. You say, well, that doesn't sound like, you know, he did anything special. No, apparently not. He just pleased God. He didn't do anything to displease God. I suppose if you don't displease God, then you must end up pleasing him. What did they do? All of these show instances in the book of Acts where they did those things. And was a man in the book of Acts. His name was Nason. And the only thing that we know about him was that he was an old saint. That's all we know about him. But he was a disciple that just did it and kept doing it. And sadly, I've known some people that aged and they didn't Christian-wise, age well. I think we're supposed to get closer to God as time goes on. I think we're supposed to have a greater testimony as life goes on, not the other way around. We're supposed to be becoming more and more like Him. We're supposed to be being conformed into the image of His Son. And so tonight, wherever you are, whatever you've accomplished, I'm sure each one of us is somewhat frustrated by where we are. We look around, we see others. The Bible says when we compare ourselves one to another, we're not wise. Why? Because there's always going to be somebody better than we are. But what's the fix for that? Have you ever wondered, you look at someone and you think to yourself, man, I wish I was that, or I wish I could do that, or I wish I could demonstrate that. Did you ever think that they were not always that way? They weren't born that way? That they did something in order to get to attain to that level. And since all flesh is grass, and we're all, once we're saved, we're all indwelt by the Spirit of God, I don't believe that there's anything that we can't attain. I believe we can learn and achieve by simply continuing. And so let's endeavor, starting right now, starting this week, in this new year, to continue. Not to be a quitter, not to be a compromiser, but simply to continue.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, King James Bible-believing Baptist church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You are invited to attend any of our Bible-centered services. Our service times are as follows. Sunday school for all ages at 9:30 a.m. Sunday worship services at 10:30 a.m. and again at 6 p.m. And our midweek prayer meeting and Bible study, Wednesday at 7 p.m. You may write to Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church at 214 Main Street, Blackstone, Massachusetts, or call us at area code 508-883-5302. For additional information about our church, please visit our website at solidrockbbc.com. May the message you've heard today speak to your heart, and remember, God loves you, Christ died for you, and you must be born again. Thank you for watching.